Hello, good morning po sa atin lahat. This is our first lesson for engineering mechanics. So this lesson is about, it is the introductory topic for engineering mechanics. So we will be talking about the concept of engineering mechanics. We'll be talking about some reviews on the basic principles of physics, laws of Newton's law of motion, as well as vector operation. So the outline of this lesson is, number one, we'll be talking about introduction to mechanics, Newton's law of motion, particles and the rigid body, and finally, we'll be talking about vectors, vector operations. So this video will be a two-part video, and then the last topic, which is vector operations, will be discussed in the next video. So let's begin. So mechanics is defined as the branch of physics that considers the action of forces on bodies or fluids that are at rest or in motion. So the primary topics of mechanics is statics and dynamics. So statics is defined as the branch of mechanics which studies the effects and distribution of forces on rigid bodies which are at rest. Okay, so as mentioned kanina, the mechanics deals with both bodies both at rest or in motion. So those who are at rest falls under the statics, and those who are in motion falls under the topic dynamics. Dynamics is the branch of mechanics which deals with the study of bodies in motion. There are two branches of dynamics. First is the kinematics, which is the geometry in motion, and then kinetics, which is the branch of mechanics that relates the force acting on a body to its mass and acceleration. So later on, as we progress with this particular course, we will be talking more in details about the concept of statics as well as the concept of dynamics. But for now, let's proceed to our second topic, which is the laws of motion. This particular topic has already been discussed in your physics for engineers. So this is just a review. As you may remember, the first law of motion is called the law of inertia. So it is defined or it is expressed as, if a particle is at rest or it is moving at a constant velocity and it is in a straight line, it will remain at rest or it will continue to move at constant velocity in a straight line unless acted upon by a force. Specifically, that force should be unbalanced force. This particular law is called the law of inertia. Okay, so look at this particular picture. Yan. So makikita natin that the law of inertia is at play in this particular picture. Why is that? Remember, yung truck meron siyang brake, no? So, if this truck is moving at a certain acceleration, and then bigla siya nag-brake, so magkakaroon ng deceleration. But, unfortunately, walang brake itong massive boulder na to. That's why, ito yung nangyari sa kanya. Nayupi yung truck, no? Kawawa naman yung driver. Anyway, that is our law of inertia. So next, the law of acceleration. So a particle acted upon by a force will accelerate in the direction of the force. That the magnitude of the acceleration is proportional to the magnitude of the force and inversely proportional to the mass of the particle. If we will write that mathematically, it is A is equal to F over M. Okay? So that is what we call the law of acceleration. Sabi nga ni Yoda, may mass times acceleration be with you. The next law is what we call the law of interaction or the law of action-reaction. This law states that for every action, there is an equal and opposite reaction. That is the forces of interaction between two particles are equal in magnitude and oppositely directed along the straight line of action. So that is what we call the law of interaction or the law of action reaction. Okay, so that is the quick review of the three laws of motion. I hope na na-review kayo because these laws will be the fundamental laws that will govern our course, which is engineering mechanics. So now, let us differentiate what particle is, what the difference between particle and rigid bodies. So particle is defined as a mass point. It possesses a mass but has no size. This is just a general definition. But in reality, everything has a size, no? Yun nga lang, relative yung size. Sabi dito, the particle is an approximate model of a body whose dimensions are negligible in comparison with all other dimensions that appear in the formulation of the problem. Example, if we are considering the sun as one of the bodies and then the earth is another one, the earth will be considered as a particle because it is so small compared to the sun. As you may see in the picture, we can no longer see the size of the suns at the earth. So therefore, it is now considered as a particle. On the other hand, a body is said to be rigid body if the distance between two material points of the body remains constant. Ibig sabihin, the body does not deform. Yung sizes ng mga bodies in play with a particular problem or particular situation is relatively constant, hindi nagbabago. However, let us remember that any body undergoes some deformation kapag they are loaded with a force. Kaya, in reality, there's no truly rigid body in the world. However, in many applications, especially in engineering applications, these deformations are so small. Kaya, they are considered as a rigid body for simplification of calculation. Okay. Now, we will be talking about vector operations. So, in your physics class, you have defined vector as a quantity that possesses or described by its magnitude and direction, in comparison to scalar quantity, which is only described by its magnitude and nor direction. So let's have some examples. We know that vector, example of vector is a displacement. Ang counterpart niya pagdating sa scalar is what we call the distance. So there are a lot of parameters that can be considered vector, and so are scalar quantities. So in this text, we adopt the following conventions. Vector are written as boldface letters. For example, this one, letter F here, stands for the force, which is in boldface letter. And the magnitude of vector, say A, is denoted by these two bars, or the absolute value of A, or the magnitude of A. Or simply, kapag nakakita kayo ng A na italized, it talks about the magnitude of the particular vector. So, in this particular text, we will be describing or writing the vector in terms of a line segment, okay, or directed line. So, makikita natin sa figure na to, itong vector A is described by the length of this particular, or the magnitude is described by the length of this arrow or directed line segment. And then, itong theta dito, this is the direction of your particular vector. When you write your vector or when you create a symbol for your vector, make it sure na ito ay at least siguro proportionate, no, dun sa value ng vector. So, kung meron kang vector na ang value ay 10, tapos meron kang another vector na ang value ng 20, so i-drawing mo siya na at least yung pangalawa is mga approximately twice nung una because the magnitude is twice. Tama? Okay, so let's proceed. Let's talk about the parallelogram law of addition as well as the triangle law. Makita natin sa figure na ito that if I have two vectors, say vector A and vector B, makita natin that if I am to add A and B, all I have to do is to project B here in this position, na makikita natin that C, being the sum of A and B, can be written from this point up to that point. So, makikita natin na it forms a parallelogram. In the same manner, sa triangle naman, ganun din. Yun nga lang, si A, nandito na siya, and then si B, instead na ang projections niya lang ang ilalagay natin, si B mismo ang imu-move natin from the tip of A, no? Papunta doon. Nandiyan na si B. So, makikita natin that C, in the same manner, is also the sum of A and B. Ang tawag din dito sa method na ito is what we call the tip-to-tail method. Okay? So, tip, papunta sa tail, and then idudugtong lang natin. Ang maganda sa triangle method is that you can use this in multiple vectors. Hindi lang dalawa. Yun nga lang, hindi na triangle ang mafo-form natin. Okay? So, let's proceed in how we can use this technique in solving for the sum of your vectors in a particular problem. Let's have an example. Say, for example, you have this particular figure that shows A, vector A, which is equal to 60 meters, and vector B, which is equal to 100 meters. So, the position A is 30 degrees above horizontal, and B is 70 degrees above horizontal. Okay, so makikita natin that R is the sum of A and B, and we are to solve for our R. So let me show you how we can solve for R, which is equal to A plus B. Okay, so makikita natin sa figure that this is A, this one, and this is B. Gagamitin natin yung tinatawag nating triangle law or the tip-to-tail method. So, imumove natin si B papunta kay sa tip ni A. Ayan. So, makikita natin ngayon that we can now draw R from the tail of A papunta dun sa tip ni B. Ayan. So, pwede natin siyang i-drawing. And this will be your R, which is equal to the sum of A, vector A, and vector B. So, makikita natin, in this particular figure, nandito siya, no? Ang problema, for us to be able to solve for the value of R, kailangan natin ang ilang mga values ng angle dito. Obviously, ditong angle na to hindi natin ito malalaman. So, agad. So, tawagin na muna natin siyang alpha. And itong part na to kaya natin isolve yan. Paano gagamitin? We will just recall the concept of, what we call this? Trigo. No? Kung maalala nyo sa trigo, kung ito ay 30 degrees, itong angle na to, itong part na to is what? That is 60 degrees. So, pwede nating sabihin na yan ay 60 degrees. Since ito ay 90 degrees, kasi right triangle na yan, kailangan lang natin i-add ang 70 sa 90 and then sa 60 and i-subtract natin siya sa 360. So, 360 minus 60, 300 na lang, minus 70, that is 230, right? Minus 90, that is 140. Kaya makaka-create tayo ng ganitong figure ngayon. Since meron na tayong value niya, madali na lang isolve kung anong value ng R. Gagamit na lang tayo ng cosine law. So, law of cosines. So, we have here R squared is equals to the value of A squared plus the value of B squared minus 2 times AB cosine of theta, which is defined as the angle opposite to R. So, what is the angle opposite to R? We have 140. So, substitute the value, execute the equation, makikita natin that R is equals to 151 meter. In the same manner, pwede na natin ngayon masolve ang value ng alpha, this one, alpha, para masolve natin later on ang direction ng R or ang angle ng R. So, law of sines naman ang gagamitin natin ngayon. So, sa law of sines naman, since alam na natin ang value ng R, pwede natin gamitin si B, and then over sine alpha, and R over sine 140. So, substitute lang natin dyan. And then, alpha is equals to 25.2. But remember that alpha is not the angle of R. It is simply the angle between A and R. Kailangan natin makuha ang angle ni, ng value ng angle ni R from the reference line, which is ito yon. So, ang gagawin natin, okay, so to solve for the angle of R or the direction of R, we simply add 30 degrees from the value of alpha, which is 25.2. So, 30 plus 25.2, 55.2. Therefore, the answer is R is equals to 151, angle 55.2 degrees. Itong problem na ito, i-pause nyo muna yung video and then try nyo i-solve ang problem na ito. So, sa problem na ito, the vertical force P of magnitude 100 kN is applied to the frame shown in figure below. Resolve P into components that are parallel to the members AB, ayan, and AC. So, ang ibig niya sabihin, meron daw force dito, right? Okay? And then may force din dito. So, ang force dito is papunta dito, and then ang force naman dito ay papunta dito. So, isusolve niyo daw ang value nitong forces na ito. Okay, pause the video, try to solve it. Pagkatapos niyong isolve, you can continue watching this video. Let's try to solve this particular problem. So, ang una natin gagawin is kailangan natin i-represent ang forces dito sa members na to. So, first is your force in member AB and then yung force mo in member AC. And then, of course, yung force mo dito sa ang kanyang load, no, si force P. So, gagamitin natin ang tip-to-tail method. Ayan. So, pag pinagdugtong-dugtong natin ang kanilang forces, makikita natin na ito na siya, no? Itong pababa is your 100 kN. Itong pababa dito, ito yung force P at AC. And then ito naman is yung force P at AB. Makikita din natin yung angles nila. Okay, so this is the 70 degrees, this is the 35 degrees, and 110 degrees, and 35 degrees. Using this information, pwede na natin ngayon ma-solve ang ating sagot. So the first triangle in figure in this figure represents the vector addition of P, which is equals to PAC plus PAB. The angles in the figure were derived from the inclination of AC and AB with vertical. So PAC is inclined at 35 degrees. It is parallel to AC, and PAB is inclined at 70 degrees. So, we can use the law of sines. So, using law of sines, we have 100 kN over sine of 35 degrees. Ito. Opposite niya, no? Then, PAB, ayan, opposite niya 35 degrees din. And finally, PAC, ang opposite niya ay 110. So, isolve muna natin si PAB. So, for PAB, we will be using this particular formula and then executing that. So, we have PAB is equals to 100 sine 35 over sine 35. Therefore, PAB is equal to 100 kilonewton. Ayan siya, no? Isosceles yung triangle natin. So, obviously, ito ay 100 din. How about PAC? PAC now, using the same law, the law of sines, substitute natin value, PAC is equals to 100 sine 110 divided by sine 35 equals 163.8 kilonewton. So, ang sagot natin, 100 and 163.8. Alright, so thank you so much for listening. Please watch the second part of this video. We will be talking about components of a vector. So, thank you so much. God bless.